الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله we are starting with a new disease today which is called arrogance kibar which is one of the greatest diseases of the heart and one of the most common ones as well And according to some of the ulama, this is the, again, this is one of the original sins. As some of them, they said that, you know, one of the first things or the first sins committed by shaitan was that he developed in his heart kibar. He had arrogance. And because of that arrogance, it led him to refuse the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so he became shaitan al-rajim, the one who was rejected, who was mardood. And now everyone curses him, even the kuffar now curse him. So he became somebody who was really outcast because of this attribute of kibr. And when we look at the introduction, we find this ayah from the Quran in Surah Ghafir, chapter number 40, ayah number 60. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Innal ladhina yastakbiruna an ibadati sayadkhuluna jahannama dakhirin." Verily, those who show arrogance against worshipping me, or those who show arrogance against my worship, we shall enter them into hell with disgrace. So those people who had kibar, just like they were arrogant, with the same kind of zilla, yani with lowness, they will be entered into Jahannam. And so this is what actually kibar is. When you look at it from a definition point of view, how did the Prophet ﷺ define kibar? What is arrogance? It was asked from him, narrated by Abdullah bin Masood radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet ﷺ actually said that no one who has an atom's weight worth of arrogance in his heart will enter paradise. That if you have even an atom's weight worth of kibar in your heart, even that small amount, then you will not enter paradise. And just to, before you get really, really scared, the ulama say that this does not mean that the person who has even an atom's weight worth of kibar will remain in the hellfire forever. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا abada. No, not like that. They said that if you have kibar, you will still enter the fire, but maybe depending on your level of kibar, you might be pulled out after a certain time. So this means that the person will not remain there. Like for example, if a person commits shirk with Allah, then he remains in the fire forever. But one who does kibar, this is still a major sin, but maybe not to the extent where you might think that he's never going to enter paradise. Because the Prophet ﷺ said that the one who has an atom's weight worth of kibar in his heart will not enter paradise. This means that he will not immediately enter paradise. Maybe later on he could possibly, but not one of the first people to enter paradise. He might have to go via the Jahannam route towards paradise. So the man asked, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what if a man likes his clothes and his shoes to look good? What if I like my clothes and my shoes, then what? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that, Inna Allaha jameelun yuhibbul jamal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beautiful and he loves beauty. And he says, Al-kibr is batarul haqq. وَغَمْتُ النَّاسِ He said that arrogance is rejecting the truth and looking down upon people. So this is now the classical definition of kibar according to Islam. That you when you, it's not that you like to wear good clothes, that's not kibar. Although this could become kibar if it fulfills the next two criteria. Which is that you reject truth and you look down upon people. So let's inshallah try to understand and examine what these things really mean for us. Having good appearance is not something bad. It's actually something encouraged that you have good appearance. But to be excessive in that might become kibar. For example, nowadays the culture of, you know, the hip-hop artists and all that, the bling-bling, the Gucci, this and that. And so when you have that type of aura about you and you have excessive spending, that might end up being kibar. And so an imam, normally what the ulama would say is that an imam of a masjid or, for example, a person who's a da'i, for example, or a person who is dealing amongst people, a teacher, a scholar, they should have a budget for their clothing. Because they are people who teach Islam to other people, so they should have a budget for their clothing. Like, let's say that I will spend X amount of money on my clothes and my shoes. Because you have to have good, decent apparel. But this does not mean that the imam will go to buy a $5,000 suit. Or for example, he'll go and he'll say, you know, I'll spend excessively because I am the imam, therefore I need to dress up in the most finest clothing. It's not like that. So this is what we understand. But from the first thing that the Prophet mentioned, that the one who is arrogant, the first quality is he's turning away from truth. Now what this means is that when you see yourself or somebody around you develop this type of personality where a person says something to you or he warns you of Allah, he says, fear Allah, my brother. And you say to him that, no, I don't want to, or this is not how we do things. If a person gives you sincere nasiha, if a person gives you advice, and you end up saying, mujhe pata theek hai, I understand, I'll go talk to someone else. Or if, for example, a sister goes to another sister and says, sister, I love you for the sake of Allah, wallahi, I love you for the sake of Allah, but really you need to cover yourself properly because this is not proper hijab. And so the sister says, you know, leave it be. Allah knows what's in my heart and, you know, stop preaching to me. So if somebody tries to do that, then this shows kibr in their heart. Because the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that the first thing about kibr, how he defined it, was rejection of truth. You don't want to accept the truth because there's ego there. You don't want to embrace it. And your ego is getting in the way. How could a person who is my peer or my counterpart show me that I'm wrong? Because the thing that really stops us or hinders us from the obedience to Allah is that when we bring our ego in the way of it. Thinking that I cannot possibly be wrong. How could I be wrong? And this becomes more of a problem the higher up you go. For example, you go as you gain more knowledge, as you get more maqam or position amongst people, and then if someone tells you that you are wrong, this becomes a bigger test. And so we find from the Khulafa Rashideen that even when, for example, somebody would stand up from the audience, an old woman, and say to Umar ibn Khattab that what you have said is not right, because the book of Allah says something else, he humbled himself. He said, the old woman has spoken the truth and I stand corrected. Whether I try doing this now to a politician, you will be shot before anything else could take place. So you understand how these people did not have any ounce of arrogance in their hearts, and whenever the truth was spoken to them, they just accepted that. So the first criteria of not having kibr is that you accept the truth when it comes to you. The second thing that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned was that the kibr is defined as looking down upon people. And so what does this mean? We find that oftentimes, because of many, many reasons, which inshallah we will discuss, we develop this type of arrogance about ourselves with anyone who we deem as lower than us in terms of knowledge, in terms of social status, in terms of class, in terms of whatever. We do not want to associate with these people. And we look down upon them. And there is an air of arrogance around us, even if we don't say anything. There is kibr, they can feel the kibr around us. And so the Prophet ﷺ, you would find that he would go into the streets. He was the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he would initiate salam with the children. Today, if there is a scholar who is walking in the street, he'll expect the opposite. That when I walk in the street, the children should flock to me and they should, you know, grab my hand and kiss my hand and say Assalamu alaikum and Shaykh and MashaAllah, Tabarakallah, all that. But the Prophet ﷺ would go to kids himself because he loved children. Second of all, he did not feel arrogance in going up and picking a child and saying Assalamu alaikum to the child. And so this shows you one of the signs that kibr is not in this person's heart. Likewise, we find that the Prophet ﷺ would do his own housework. He would love to sit with the fuqara and the masakeen and eat with them. This was not a problem for him. Although he was the military leader, he was a general, he was a government official, he was a prophet, he was actually fulfilling so many positions at the same time. Yet he had no problem sitting with the poor and even mending his own shoes. As a matter of fact, one time Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was mending his shoes. And a man came and he says, oh, Amirul Mumineen, you are doing this? He said, why not? He said, but you're Amirul Mumineen. He says, so what? Am I not a human being? So this is how they would treat it. But now, I mean, imagine if we had to do some of our own housework. Like, for example, you know, clean the dishes, sweep the floor, take out the trash, and all of these things. And I find in the Western culture, they still do these things. But in Pakistani culture, alhamdulillah, we have problems with these things. You know, the father will say to the son, and they have their own share of ills, agreed. The father will say to the son, son, take the trash out. He'll take it out, no problem. He won't say, you know, call the maid, because they don't have maids. They don't have servants. But we become a little bit spoiled because of the whole culture of servants and maid, and we think this is beneath me to clean something like this, although this is from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If he could do it, what makes us so special? And so think about mending shoes. Now mending shoes, it has two, it's a two in one, because on the one hand it shows you that a person will go as far as to mend a shoe, which itself seems like an insignificant job, and on the other hand they wouldn't toss their shoes out. You know, if the sole of the shoe is broken, they wouldn't say, you know, I need a new pair of Adidas now, I need a new set of Nikes. They would say, I'll fix it. And they would feel no shame in putting that shoe again, though it was mended. If the shirt tore, they would mend it. They would put a patch on it. Not that the people would say, oh, he's wearing a patched shirt. Umar ibn Khattab, this is his famous line. When he was actually told, when he was going towards Jerusalem, his companion told him that, you know, Amir al-Mu'mineen, this is not appropriate because these people, they like fancy clothes and all that. He said, Islam did not come to give us izzah through clothing. We got izzah through Islam. And he recalled that I used to be a lowly sheep herder. I used to herd sheep. And now I'm Amir al-Mu'mineen. I used to herd a flock of sheep. That was my domain. That was the extent of my control. And now I'm Amir al-Mu'mineen with an area which basically goes from the edge of Isfahan, yani Persia, right up till Morocco. This is the belt I have. And this came why? Because of my clothes? Because of Islam. So we need to change our outlook towards certain things if we need to understand where is the izzah coming from. And so why is this such a big problem? Why is kibar such a big thing? Because we find this hadith from Abu Dawud, that it's hadith Qudsi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that pride is my cloak and honor is my garment. Whoever seeks to compete with me concerning them, I will throw him in the fire. So the only being upon whom it is suited for him to have pride, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of his names is Al-Mutakabbir, the one who is worthy of having pride. And what about us sitting here on planet Earth, the speck of dust that we might be, and we think that no, we are all that. And if you just, for just a few seconds, try to visualize your own existence on this planet. Right now we are in a city called Islamabad, in a sector called F8, in a house, number which I will not mention for the sake of the online audiences. So we are in F8 in Islamabad, and you go and you zoom out, right? You see you're in Punjab, you're in Pakistan, you're in Asia, you're on planet Earth. Where is this planet Earth? Planet Earth is one of the planets in the solar system which contains 8 planets. It used to be 9, Pluto has been declassified. Boo-hoo. So we now have 9, we have 8 planets. So, and in the center of them is a star, which is known as the sun, which is 93 million miles from planet Earth. And light takes 8 minutes to travel to Earth from the sun. That's how far it is. And if the sun was to explode now, we would find out 8 minutes later that the sun is no more. And this is known as our solar system. So the sun is massive. I mean, just compared to the sun, the earth seems like insignificant. And so this sun itself is one of the stars in the many stars that are in our galaxy, known as the Milky Way. And when you look up at the night sky and you look at the stars, these are the stars that you can see in the Milky Way. And these are close to about roughly 300 billion stars. 300 billion stars in the Milky Way. The sun is one of them. And the sun is nicknamed the yellow dwarf. Yellow because of its color, dwarf because of its size. So it feels a little insignificant when it's compared to all the other stars. And so there are other stars which are far bigger than the sun, far more stronger and more vibrant and all of those things, which we can see in the night sky. This is just our galaxy known as the Milky Way. And just like the Milky Way, there are 250 billion galaxies in the observable universe. And some galaxies far, far bigger than the Milky Way, containing far more stars than the Milky Way. You get the point? So a person sitting in Islamabad says, I am all that. I am this, that and the other. And Allah, and this is the universe, and this is observable universe, because the universe, you can observe only so much. Because we can only see up to a certain extent. After that, even we can not see. So beyond a certain point, even our telescopes fail. So in the observable universe, we say there are about 250 billion galaxies, out of which one of them is ours, out of them one star, 300 billion and so on. And so if you imagine that, this is just the universe that we know of. What is the comparison of the universe to the kursi of Allah? It is like, according to the Hadith of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it is like a ring in a desert. And what is the comparison of the kursi to the arsh? It's like a ring in a desert. And then you come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now imagine yourself in this, and a person who now feels arrogant, that I think I'm all that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking down upon you and thinking, this guy, he is doing kibar, he's smaller than a speck of dust. He's having kibar, he's feeling arrogant, for what purpose? And so this is why kibar becomes such a huge thing, because it is, you do not possess those things to be able to challenge the authority of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or to be, for example, like an atheist who defies Allah. He stands on branches and says, I do not believe in Allah. I don't believe that there is a God. Subhanallah, imagine people saying that. And look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still gives these people. Why? Because Allah is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. But don't you think for a second that if Allah is giving you, He will not hold you to account for what you have done. Because Allah gives people a time period. And when that time period is over, that's it. It's either Jannah or Jahannam. And you'll find out the reality on the Day of Judgment. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا. On the day when you will see that your Rabb will descend along with the angels, صَفًّا صَفًّا, in rows. I mean, just imagine, and it will put you in your place. Imagine looking towards the sky and you find that the angels are descending in like an army. And how many angels are there? Many, 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 many more than human beings. The heavens creaked because of the weight of the angels at one point in time. That's how many they are. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes with them. وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا وَجِيَ يَوْمَئِذٍ بِجَهَنَّمْ. And so people at that time, they start to reflect, what did I do? Oh my God, what have I done? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the only one who's worthy of pride is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who's Zul Jalali wal Ikram, who's the owner of all bounties. He's the one who can have pride, but not us. No way, not even close to us. Jibreel alayhi salam, whom the Prophet saw on the horizon, the entire horizon was covered with Jibreel alayhi salam. Even he doesn't have takabbur. And yet still we can say that no, I have some kibar in my heart. According to the hadith mentioned in Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet mentions that whilst a man was walking, dragging his garment with pride and with his hair nicely combed, Allah caused the earth to swallow him and he will go on sinking in it until the day of resurrection. So right now that man is sinking in the earth. And if somehow we could do like an x-ray scan of the whole earth, we would find that there is a person who's sinking in the earth. And this was that man whom the Prophet mentions. He was dragging his garment with a pride. He was feeling very arrogant. And because one of the signs of arrogance is that you let your garments drag on the floor, like the kings would do in the olden days. And at the same time, he has his hair all combed up. You could translate that into modern terms also. That the guy, he put on the gel, you know, looking good in the mirror and all that, and he walks out with a attitude because he thinks, you know, this is it. And you know, you, for example, look at the hip hop industry. It's 90% of it is kibar. 90% of it is kibar. You know, the bling bling, the 21 inch rims, the this and that. It's all kibar. People are feeling proud of materialistic things. And so this is all they talk about. Either it's violence, you know, busting caps at people, or it's basically talking about kibar, like how a person can be better than the other person, and how trying to diss the other person and exalting yourself. This is all what rap music is. And even if you go to other genres as well, you find similar themes where people start to actually feel proud of themselves. And imagine this in contemporary terms: a person listening to the headphones and he's listening to some music which is filled with kibar. Even if it's something like, you know, the soundtrack of Dawn or something. And he's listening to it and he's thinking, you know, I'm the man. I'm the man. And he's walking with that attitude. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about these people, those who walk arrogantly on earth. The sign of the believer is that he's not arrogant when he walks on the earth. And according to the contemporary scholars, it's not just your walk. It's the way you drive also. Do you drive with arrogance? Because sometimes we lean back, one hand on the steering wheel, and we're looking like this. This is kibar. Watch out. looking at the other person's car and giving him the eye. You know, what's up? That kind of thing. This is part of kibar. I mean, maybe a smaller type of kibar, but still kibar nonetheless. So the way you carry yourself on the streets or the way you push people off the road, this is all part of kibar. So we have to understand this is a severe sickness that can be part of our personalities. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And so from Sahih Muslim, we find out that Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, he reported that the Prophet, he said, the garden and the fire, they argued, Jannah and Nar, they argued with one another, and said, and the fire said, I have the tyrants and the arrogant. And Jannah said, I have the weak and the poor people. Jahannam is saying, I have the tyrants and the arrogant. And Jannah is saying, I have the weak and the poor. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judged between them and said, you the garden are my mercy. By you I shall show mercy to whomever I wish. You the fire are my punishment. By whom I punish whomever I will. It is my duty to fill both of you. So this does not mean that in Jannah, no rich person will enter. But what it means is that the majority of people in Jannah are those who are the weak, oppressed and poor. And the majority of people in Jahannam, the main quality of these people is that they were tyrants or they were arrogant. Either they were oppressing people or they were just arrogant people. And likewise, a similar narration mentioned in Bukhari and Muslim, Haritha ibn Wahab, he mentions that, I heard the Prophet ﷺ say, shall I tell you about the people of the fire? And he said, all those who are coarse, yani who are harsh, who are domineering, who like to dominate other people, and those who are arrogant. This is the definition of those who will be entering the fire. Those who are harsh people, rude people, those who want to dominate other people, and those who are arrogant, according to the hadith from Bukhari and Muslim. And so what happens to these people who show arrogance? One of the things, and this is enough for us to know as a punishment, is that they become devoid of one of the most amazing mercies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like the hadith mentioned in Bukhari and Muslim, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he actually reports that the Prophet ﷺ said, on the day of resurrection, Allah will not look at anyone who drags his waist wrapper out of pride. The one who drags his garment out of pride, Allah will not look at him. And just understand this. I mean, if this was the only thing to stop us, that your creator, your Lord, your master, he will refuse to look at you. And you say, Ya Allah, please look at me because you, like, bless me, forgive me, have mercy on me, Ya Allah. And he doesn't even want to look at you because of your arrogance. Have you ever seen a child who's trying to win the mother's heart over and saying, Mama, please, I'm sorry. And the mama is not looking. How does a child repent? Starts to cry, Mama, please. Because he knows, I have nobody else except my mama. If I can't get her, then there is nobody else. So on the day of judgment, a person will, if you won't get mercy from Allah, who are you seeking mercy from? If Allah turns away from you, you got no one. No one can save you that day. And so the next hadith mentioned in Muslim, also narrated by Abu Huraira, you know, he mentions that the Prophet ﷺ said, there are three people that Allah will not speak to on the day of rising, nor purify, nor look at them, and they will have a painful punishment. So three people, and all three of them, neither will Allah speak to them, nor purify them, nor look at them, and they will have a painful punishment. Yani these are the worst of the lot. Who are they? Number one, an old adulterer. Adulterers in general are cursed. But an old one, because, you know, right now it's time for him to think about his grave. Right now it's time to think about death and contemplate. Yani people stop sinning because they lack the strength. But even in his old age, if he has the strength to sin, then this is the worst person in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know, astaghfirullah, there are people like that who you can find even today. You know, old people, and the way they speak, I mean, go to a wedding ceremony or something similar where you have some of these uncles roaming around and look at the filth that's coming out of their mouth. You know, it really makes you think, you know, how come are you saying all of this? It's not like, I mean, even if you were a teenager, I'd understand. He's a young kid, doesn't know much, acceptable. But a person of 50, 60, 70 years talking like this, really, it's disgusting. And the second person he actually mentions is a lying ruler. A ruler who speaks lies to people. And how common is that? Who will not be part of the mercy. Allah will not look at him. Allah will not purify him. And he gets the worst punishment. Allah will not speak to him. And then a poor person who is arrogant. Why a poor person? Because a poor person has nothing to be arrogant of. And yet, if still he is arrogant, then again, like the old adulterer, this seems like an extreme case as well. That without having wealth, he's still arrogant. Without having position, authority, power, he's still arrogant for what particular purpose? Although all of arrogance is blameworthy. Now let's look at some types of arrogance, how it can actually manifest in our times today. And there are six things which I must mention. The first one is arrogance due to deen and knowledge. Arrogance due to deen and knowledge. And this, I mentioned a few days earlier, that this is the home turf of shaitan. This is Iblis's playing area. Because he was once a pious worshipper. He was a devout worshipper once. But he became arrogant. So when a practicing brother or a practicing sister becomes arrogant, this is now you're walking straight into Iblis's trap. When you start thinking, I am mashallah so learned. I am mashallah so scholarly. I pray mashallah all five prayers. I play tahajjud. I do fasting in the month of Ramadan. Mashallah, I am so that. And when you look at other people, you are disgusted by them. A sister, mashallah, who covers herself up. And there's another one who doesn't cover herself that well. And you look at her with this disgust. And yes, if there is ikhlas, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts that. But you shouldn't be feeling disgust towards people that way. Because you were once on the edge of the fire and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed you from that. And so why are you now having negativity towards other people? Yes, guide this person. Talk to them. Maybe they will accept it. Because wallahi, sometimes there are people who you might think are far away from deen. You give them one nasiha and they say, labbaik Allahumma labbaik. And they accept it completely. Like the people used to say about Umar ibn al-Khattab, that the donkey of his father can say la ilaha illallah, but these words will never come out of the mouth of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Yet this same man became the second Khalifa of Islam. And what a man he was. So never judge a book by its cover. And never think of yourself as all that. Just every time you realize that I am doing something nice for the sake of Allah, say Alhamdulillah and humble yourself. Alhamdulillah, humble yourself. And say to Allah that, oh Allah, do not hold me to account for what these people think of me. Even if people praise you for your knowledge, for your taqwa, for your ikhlas. MashaAllah, aap bade achhe bhai ho. Aapko main har roz masjid mein dekhta hoon. MashaAllah, just lower yourself down. Allah has given you tawfiq. Otherwise, you could have been home doing something else. So just humble yourself. That it is only the mercy of Allah that this has happened. As a matter of fact, go home and cry. That, oh Allah, somebody praised me and I'm not worthy of it. This is what the ulama would do. Every time somebody, because ulama, the real ulama, they don't like to get praised. They feel uncomfortable. The whole body starts to tingle and they change the subject as soon as somebody starts praising them. Because they know this will kill them. This is like somebody stabbing daggers in their heart. And they don't want it. They don't want to hold any kibar in themselves. The second thing is wealth. Arrogance based on wealth. Because you have more money than the next guy, therefore you feel proud, you feel arrogant. But because I have a better mobile phone, cheap guy, you know, he just has a Nokia 3310. And I have an iPhone. I have a Galaxy. And so you think, automatically the thought comes in your mind, this guy is insignificant. He's lower than me. He hasn't spoken a word to you yet. But you just are at the dinner table, you're just about to have dinner. You put your phone on the table, he puts his. And automatically you think, oh man, this guy is no good. Kibar. Likewise, any property, for example, if you start to feel that, and who gave you this property? Who was the one who gave you this? It came from Allah. And who did not give it to this person? Allah. Allah wrote your rizq down before you were even born. So why are you feeling arrogant? Allah wrote it down before you were born. If you were born into a rich family, what was your kamal in this? If you were born into a family which had millions, and if the next guy was born into a family which was a poor family, they lived in huts in the, you know, in the middle of sectors, what's his fault? And so you think to yourself, I am better than this guy just because I was born in that family? And there are people who have arrogance on that. They say, we deserved it because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose us amongst the people. We deserve this well because Allah, kuch to pasand aaya hoga hamare andar. Allah must have liked something in me. Allah made you. He's testing you. He's put you in ibtila, the one of the greatest tests when you're tested with wealth. He wants to see how you will react, how you will deal with this. So people, the you know, feeling arrogance because of wealth is the second thing. The third is due to family lineage, caste or tribe. And one of the brothers, Suhaib Webb, he was mentioning that he entered, when he actually accepted Islam for the first time when he was in the US, he went to a masjid, and there in the masjid, he accepted Islam, he was a new Muslim. And he said that, I was praying, I think Maghrib Salah it was or something. And he said that we prayed, and then right after we finished prayer and we said Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah, somebody started saying the Iqamah again. And these people were already there in the masjid when the first Iqamah went off. And so he said, he was so confused that how come you guys are, these guys were there before, why didn't they pray with you guys? So one of the uncles, he grabbed him and he said, these people, the uncle was Pakistani by the way, he said, these people are from MQM. They are Muhajir party. You know, they 1947, they came from this place. They pray their own. We are, and he grabbed him and said, we are Punjabi. And he is a revered Muslim, mashallah. He said, we are Punjabi, and so we should pray first and they should pray second. So he said, I had no clue what a Punjabi is. Later on, I checked it, found out who these people are. And so this is how sometimes people, you know, because of tribes and race and this can become such a fitna. And so people have this thing that, you know, for example, they say, we only marry into this caste. Hum log, for example, you know, Gujjar hai, hum Gujjaron mein dete hain. Hum Malik hai, Malikon mein dete hain. Hum Suhay hai, hum Rajji hai, hum Rajjon mein dete hain. You know, it's actually like that. So, you know, it's because of, and why do we say that? Because we have this preconceived notion that our caste is superior. Did you choose to be born in this caste? Did you select it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put all the caste before you, that which one do you, and you said, you know what, I'm going to pick, Raja's the name. Thank you. Did you do that? No, you just born out of pure chance maybe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just decided that for you. And yet we feel arrogant because of that. So this is kibar as well. When we do it based on our caste and lineage or tribe. The fourth one is physical appearance. Again, something that we did not choose. If a person does not look very attractive, it's not his fault. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him that way. And for you to think that I am better than him, especially with the sisters. Because sisters, gonna, maybe this competition is more than it's in the brothers. You know, who looks better? That's why they have Miss World. Miss World, why are you competing? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you. What's the big deal in that? Is this some skill? Are we like, is this like some kind of like a 400 meter race or something? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you, and just because of that, you have pride and kibar. And they put the crown on their head and they're like, you know, this is Miss Universe now. This is Miss World now. And everybody's like, wow, you are fantastic. You have done so much hard work. What hard work? The only hard work you've done is you were just born. That's it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you. And so people feeling proud on that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made me this way. And looking down upon others based on that he made me so, she's so cheap, and this guy is so ugly, and this guy is so, this also happened. And it happens a lot in high schools, universities, and so on and so forth. Even later on, this thing carries on. And sometimes in schools and colleges, you understand that circles are made based on looks. All the good-looking people hang out together because they don't want to hang out with those who are not that attractive. And so circles are formed. And these are circles of kibar, where they all feed each other's ego all the time. You know, all the model type guys hang out together. All the model type girls hang out together. And all the athletes hang together, and all these guys, type people hang together. And then this also results in arrogance being formed. Likewise, the fifth one is being arrogant about a skill or a craft that you know how to do. For example, if you can run fast or if you can do this, even having too much arrogance. For example, Sahaba used to compete with one another. They would race with one another. They would compete in wrestling and so on. All jais, all allowed. No problem. But when you start looking down on the person, when you say, I own you, this is kibar. When you say, you got owned, and you say things like that, this is part of kibar. When you tell the other person that, you know, you are nothing, you are, I am all that, and you are nobody, then this becomes kibar. As long as you compete, for example, you play ping pong, you play basketball, no problem. As long as it's healthy competition, no problem. You can even say, man, that was a good shot, right? And even if you hit a six, you're like, wow, that was a good six, no problem. But when you say my six was awesome and yours was garbage, this is now a problem. Because this actually means that you're elevating yourself and you're degrading somebody else. So don't degrade people. That's the main thing. And the sixth point is kibber because of position and authority. Because I am in a position of, I am the head of the Muslim Students Federation. I am the head of the, for example, Students Association. Or for example, the monitor of my class. Or the CR. Or I am the head of this and that. Because, or I have this title. I am a doctor. I am a professor. I am a so-and-so. Because of that kibber coming in your heart. And then people chasing these titles. I will not rest until I become this designation. Because once I get this designation, then I feel good about myself. Otherwise, I'm not feeling good. And so people competing for these positions and titles. This is kibber. So inshallah, problems are severe. And one thing that I must also mention in addition to this is that the ulama say that, you know, one of the scholars, he mentioned, and this just killed me. You know, he said that if you go to a gathering and you find that you are the most humble person in that gathering, and really you are, and you think that, you know, I am, mashallah, I'm so humble. And these people are talking, and these people are talking about garbage. They're talking about filth, like they're talking about, let's say, Bollywood and this and that. And so you walk in there and you're like, astaghfirullah, what's going on? Alhamdulillah, I'm not like that. They say even that is kibar. Kahan jaye? We're like learning diseases of the heart, and we're like, now where do we go? This is hard work. I mean, if you want Kalbin Salim, then you got to do some hard work. And really, I mean, imagine yourself in a state of completely non-kibar. This is a person who's so humble, so down to earth. And you know, we're talking about the state of Zen and the state of spiritual calm and spiritual bliss when you remove all of these impurities. You know, when you're in that state of humility and humbleness, wallahi, is something beautiful. When you completely let all kibar out of you, it's all gone out of your system. And even if you make mistakes, then you still repent and, you know, turn back to Allah. Ya Allah, I had that moment of kibar. Ya Allah, forgive me for that. And so you try to make yourself think, you know, and you are in that state where you are humble before people. No matter what people say, you're like, you just put your head down. It's okay. It's all right. It's not because of me. And we talked about this example yesterday that Ali ibn Abi Talib, when the person in battle spat on him, he refused to kill him. Because he realized that I will not be killing him for the sake of Allah. I'll be killing him because he spat on my face. So he put the sword back and he walked away. This is control. Wallahi, this is control. I mean, obviously this is Sahaba we're talking about. But still, if we can try to emulate their way, this is what is actually desired. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him in Surah Al-Kahf, chapter 18, ayah number 110, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tell them, I'm a man. Just like you. Ana basharun mislukum. Prophet ﷺ is being told to tell people. And who is Prophet ﷺ? He's the person who got all those miracles. The splitting of the moon. The, you know, food being increased for him. You know, and all of those amazing miracles that he did. Water gushing forth from his fingernails and all of those things. Stones talking to him, hearing them. You know, and so he experienced all of those miracles. He had knowledge like nobody else had. He was receiving revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He had prophethood. He was a Nabi and a Rasul and an Abd of Allah. He traveled through the heavens in the journey of Isra wal Miraj. He had that experience to him. He was Rahmatul Lil Alameen. And he had the best character, Uswatun Hasana. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, go and tell the people, Ana Basharun Mislukum. I am a man just like you. Yuha ilayya. Just the only difference is I get revelation. Bas. Otherwise, I'm just a man like you. Now, if this lesson is teaching us, if the Prophet ﷺ can tell people, I'm a man like you, who is he telling this to? All of the Sahaba. Bilal, who is a slave. Habshi. Ana basharun mislukum. I'm a man just like you. To the person who came into the masjid and he urinated inside the masjid. And the Prophet ﷺ dealt with him so peacefully. Tell these people, I'm a man just like you. You make mistakes. No problem, it's okay. We're all human beings. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us through the Prophet ﷺ that if he can do it, what about you? And so this is mentioned that one time a man came into Medina and he found some people sitting in a circle and he said, where is Muhammad? And the Prophet ﷺ said, I am Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do you understand? The person could not identify out of all of these people who is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this happened even when the Prophet was traveling with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. People would not know which one of them is the Prophet. Because he did not show a pomp and glitter about himself. that, you know, I will walk two steps ahead of you at all times. I will be elevated on this thing at all times. I will dress up like this at all times. No, he didn't do that about himself. He just blended in. Although he was a prophet and a Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in Sahih Muslim it is mentioned that there was a man who was not a Sahabi. He came to Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, and he said to him, and he started praising him excessively, like, you know, beyond, when you go beyond the limits. And he started praising him beyond the limits, and a companion of the Prophet who was standing nearby, he picked up a handful of dirt and he threw it in the guy's face. And he said, "What's wrong with you? Why are you doing this?" And he said, "Wallahi, I heard the Prophet say that if you hear someone praising someone excessively, then take some dirt and throw it in his face." Because, you see, this is more dangerous than you actually stabbing your brother. Because this is called madha, yani excessive praise. There is something called sana, which is praise which is justifiable. And then madha is basically when you praise someone beyond their means. Matlab, you say, "Brother, aap jaisa koi aaj tak paida nahi hua, you are the one and only, you are the savior of all humanity, you are the one who we've been waiting for," and you just keep on going. So this is when you, jisko hum kehte hain flattery. So when you find somebody, when you often, if you like look around politicians, you'll find people, you know, are flattering them. "You are the man, you are the man." So you take some dust and throw it in the face. Because this is what the Prophet taught, that do that. And so we actually find how dangerous this actually really is. One of the shayukh from Senegal, a contemporary scholar, he was a hafiz at the age of 10, and he memorized the four different styles of recitation by the age of 14. And mashallah, he's a very top scholar. He mentions that, "I memorized the Quran in a village in Senegal, and my father was taking me to get my picture taken because I had gotten my hips done and I was getting my picture taken for some kind of, I don't know, passport requirements or something like this. So he said, I was dressed in a very nice outfit because I had memorized Quran and now it was all finished. So he was wearing, you know, clothes of the ulama, and he was feeling good about himself. You know, alhamdulillah, Quran all done, mashallah, you know, now I can feel good. And his father was a mufti at that time, you know, one of the grand muftis of that area. And so they tried to travel by bus. And while they were traveling, he said that there was a woman on the bus who was carrying with her a portable toilet. You know, the ones that children use, like little children, 3, 4, 5, they have this little plastic toilet seat. So he said that the child defecated in that seat. And so the woman, she asked the conductor to stop the bus because she wanted to, because it was really smelly, she wanted to, you know, go outside of the bus, clean it and bring it back. So the conductor asked the driver to stop the bus was stopped. And as the woman was about to get up, the father of this young scholar said, "Wait, sister, my son will do it." And the son is looking at his father that, "Me?" He said, "Yes, you will do it." And so he went outside, he took it and he cleaned it while he was wearing like very nice clothes. He cleaned it and he brought it back inside. And so when he sat with his father said to him, "You need to humble yourself." This was the advice given to his father, by his father to him. That don't think of yourself, just because you're hafiz of Quran, don't think that now you are all that. So the first thing I'm teaching you now is to humble yourself. And a lot of the ulama, when they would write their books, one of the concluding chapters would be dealing with this subject, how to humble yourself. That now that you have learned this book, now that you have learned all of this knowledge, humble yourself. Don't make this knowledge, for example, as soon as you finish the book, you're like, "Alhamdulillah, I finished it. Now I'm better than all of these people in the class because I know more than them. Haha." So the last chapter would always be, humble yourself. You're not better than anybody else. If you've done this, it's through the tawfiq of Allah. Don't think that you are somebody awesome. It's Allah that gave you the opportunity to actually do this. So this is an excellent example. Now the question is, how do we make arrogant people reflect on their arrogance? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the perfect solution in the Quran. In, for example, Surah Tariq and various other places, he mentions, for example, فَلْيَنْزُرِ الْإِنسَانُ مِمَّا خُلِقْ خُلِقَ مِنْ مَا إِنْ دَافِقْ يَخْرُجُ مِنْ بَيْنِ ثُلْبِ وَالتَّرَائِبِ. That let man look at from what he was created. He was created from a water gushing forth, proceeding from between the backbone and the ribs. This is Surah Tariq, chapter 86, ayah number 5 to 7. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Abasa, chapter 80, ayat number 18 to 19, مِنْ أَيِّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقَ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ خَلَقَهُ فَقَدَّرَ. That from what did we create you? From a dirty fluid? From a nutfa? This is where you came from? So an arrogant person, if he just sort of ponders for 5 minutes, where am I coming from? Where is my origin from? It should just humble him down. Really, I mean, seriously. I mean, coming from a dirty fluid and to then be arrogant that, you know, I'm all that. What were your origins like? And the ulama mentioned this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he wanted, he could have made human beings be born like plants are born, like gracefully coming out of the earth and blossoming into a flower. People could have been born that way. But the birth is a scary process, especially if it involves a lot of blood and all of this stuff. And the doctors, and you see people are being like, you know, they're taking stuff out and all that. Also, they said that it's to do with the private parts, which is why it becomes even more filthy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, where is he originating you from? And where are you coming out from? And so if you understand that, you'll be like, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting you in your place. That even if for a second you think that you are something, no, you're not. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have made you come out from vapor in a beautiful way, but he didn't do that. He made you go through that process so that you understand your origins at all times. At the end of the day, who are you? So I think if a person reflects on this, never will kibar be coming into his heart. The other thing which is similar to kibar is ujub, which is also a type of kibar, but the difference between kibar and ujub, which we can translate as self-praise, is basically because in kibar you need at least two people. One is the mutakabbir and the other is the mutakabbir alay. Yani, one is the person who's feeling arrogant and the other is the one who is feeling arrogant over. Because in kibar, you have to have two people. I am better than you. Like the shaitan said, I am better than him. I am made of fire, he is made of clay. Kibar. So you need at the minimum two people in kibar. But in ujub, you only need one person. Because I could be looking at the mirror and I'd be like, man, I am so cool. And this is ujub. When I'm praising myself. And I could be doing this, for example, I look in the mirror, I look at my car and I'm like, wow, man, I am just amazing. I got this. So this is part of ujub, which is a shade less than kibar, but it's still a form of kibar. And we inshallah seek refuge from that. So a person who has that, you know, mirror, mirror on the wall type of attitude, you know, the witch from, or the queen from Snow White, every single morning praising yourself for nothing that you've done. Allah made you and now you're feeling arrogant in your own domain. You're not telling anyone I'm better than you. You're just looking at yourself and praising yourself. Self-contentment. Not saying Alhamdulillah, it is from Allah. And if Allah has given me, maybe he can take it away also. So this becomes part of wajib. The Prophet ﷺ, he actually mentions the end of those who have kibr. He said that on the day of resurrection, the arrogant will be gathered like ants in the form of men. Hakir, very small, like ants they'll come. Like men were as small as ants. Humiliation will overwhelm them from all sides. They will be driven to a prison with the hottest fire rising over them and they will be given to drink from the juice of the inhabitants of hell. What is the juice of the inhabitants of hell? Whatever blood, pus and everything that drops out of them, that's their juice. So imagine how small these people are on the Day of Judgment. The way they perceive themselves in dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes them like ants on the Day of Judgment. And this is classified as Hasan and mentioned in At-Tirmidhi. Also another Sheikh from Egypt, his name was Imam Sharawi. He was a scholar of Tafsir in the last 100 years. And he would give darses on Fridays on television to close to about 7 million people. And one day he went to the masjid and a different masjid than he would normally go to. For example, normally ulama go to their madrasa masjid. So they stay within the confines of their own institute, for example. And so he went to the main masjid in Cairo. And when he went there, obviously he started realizing that everybody's watching him. Because obviously he's a big sheikh. So he quickly left the gathering. And so one of the guys, he just went to the washroom. And he saw that this sheikh was cleaning the toilets. And he said, Sheikh, what are you doing? And he said, while I was in that gathering, and while he's wearing the robe, by the way, he's actually cleaning the toilets. And he said, while I was in that gathering, a thought came to my mind that I am such an amazing scholar and look how people are looking at me. And kibar was born in my heart. And immediately to shun it, I ran to the toilets and started mopping them to humble myself down. And I know from example, like for example, when I was in the UK, I had the opportunity to work in different areas. And not that I was teaching myself how to deal with kibar, but this was basically to earn some extra change to travel Europe. You know, so I was working in a factory over there, a lettuce factory, very difficult job. I was also working as a garbage man, garbage collection, disposal and all that, and also working as a waiter in certain restaurants, and so all of these things. So in Pakistan, when you do these things, people are like, oh my God, you're doing that? Oh, that's crazy. But there, it's like people, generally students will get into these things. And wallahi, I don't think I've learned more from my education in UK as much as I've learned in doing these odd jobs. How do people treat you? How do people deal with you as a garbage man? Because they think of you as a uniform. Whether you're behind a counter, whether you dress like a waiter, or they treat you like an occupation, not a human being. And think about how you treat waiters. Do you think they're human beings? When you walk in, you think it's just bow ties. It's just a bow tie and a guy. It's just a random guy. Maybe he doesn't have feelings. He's a robot. And so people deal with them. So wallahi, really humbles you down. Especially collecting garbage. Really, it will really knock sense into you. And so, you know, and people will curse you. They will abuse you because of certain things. You know, you are very late. You are very this. You are very that. Clean up this. Clean up that. And you're like, if only you knew what my house is like back home. If only you knew who my father is. You know, because this kibar comes into your heart. If only you knew who I'll still do it, because still it's humbling me down. It's humiliation. Yet it makes you gain certain wisdom. And so the symptoms that are mentioned by Sheikh Saleh Al-Munajjid in his book, he mentions some of them. I'll mention about 12 of them, inshallah. He says, number one, that the symptom that shows that you are arrogant. Number one, lack of religion or boasting about religion. Both are in the same category. Either you are not practicing because you are too arrogant to practice, or if you are practicing, then you are boastful. Number two, you walk with conceit. There is an attitude in your walk. Number three, you drag your garments. Number four, you like when people honor you and they stand up on your behalf. You like it when everybody stands up, you know. And so this is, Prophet ﷺ really discouraged this, standing up of people. Likewise, loudness of your voice in speech amongst people. Then when 5-6 people are talking, you become the loudest of them. Likewise, mocking other people, making fun of other people. Backbiting, riba. Number eight, distancing yourself from the fuqara and the masakeen. Not liking to sit with, you know, poor people breaking their fast. Or for example, sitting in the masjid with them, eating with them. No, it's beneath you. Then this is part of arrogance. Not accepting nasiha. Somebody gives you advice, you're like, I don't need this. You know, take it, you know, keep it to yourself. Point number 10, not seeking ilm, because you think you already know too much. Number 11, not saying salam to people. Not initiating salam. You know, always expecting others will say salam to me, I will not do it. And number 12, not walking alone. And what does this mean? This means that you do not desire, like for example, you know, over here we have motorcades. We have a whole convoy of vehicles following someone. And so over here, a person who desires, when I walk in the street, people should be with me. Walking alone is not nice. So this is also part of kibr. The cure, 6 items of cure, inshallah. Number one, reflection upon your existence, as we mentioned the ayat from the Quran, from Surah Abasa, from Surah Tariq, and various other surahs. Reflect upon your existence, where you're coming from, inshallah, that will humble you down. Number two, make sincere dua to Allah, that Allah remove kibr from my heart. And have desire to change it. If you don't desire it, then it's not going to happen. Desire, I don't want to be arrogant. I want to be humble. Inshallah, it will happen. Number three, always praising Allah. Even if people praise you, you divert it to Allah. People say, man, you're amazing. No, I'm not amazing. It's Allah who's amazing. Always saying Alhamdulillah. No matter if people praise you, don't praise you, whatever happens, just keep praising Allah and divert the praise from yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Point number four, saying salam first. Get into the habit of saying salam to your servants, your maids, your workers. Say salam to them. Really, it will humble you down. As soon as you walk into a house, don't expect them to say salam. Assalamu alaikum, chacha, kaise hain aap, khairiyat se? Assalam, chote, khairiyat hai, theek ho, are you okay? Do it yourself. And they'll be surprised also. And if you do it, inshallah, you will remove arrogance from your heart. And say to those children also. Don't expect that children will say salam to me. Say it to them, because this is from the sunnah. And the sixth point is doing housework. Washing dishes, doing cleaning your own things and all that. This will also humble you down. Because the Prophet ﷺ would not come to the house and say, you know, you expect me to do this? You expect me to clean? I'm not doing this. Do you know who I am? I'm Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He never said that. He would do the housework. So what about us? So inshallah, these are just 6 tips, 6 very quick tips to inshallah remove kibar from our hearts. I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us tawfiq to remove this evil sin from our heart and this evil disease, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us humbleness and humility in all the things that we do inshallah. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Brother Taha has just kept this book on my table. I'll just mention what this is. This is a book for 450 rupees by Sheikh Abdul Jabbar Bilal. I have read some of it, and I for today's lecture I also took some notes from this. This is called Dil Se Dil Tak. It's not the title of an Indian movie. It's a book about tazkiyah of your... Actually, our entire course, The Spiritual Cardiologist, it is pretty much a very good reference for all that we're studying. It mentions diseases. It actually mentions cures and all of that stuff. So apart from all the other books that I've recommended as reference material, for example, Dawai Shafi by Imam Ibn Qayyim, or the two books by Sheikh Saleh Al-Munajjid, add this one to the list. If you want to purchase it, it's available here. We have plenty of copies. It's for 450 rupees. Those of you who would like to can give the money to Brother Taha, and inshallah he'll be able to facilitate you in that. And even if you don't have the money now, you can always come tomorrow and make payments and so on. Ji, do we have a question? Brothers who want to leave can go inshallah. I don't want to hold anybody back. When we are in the battlefield. Okay. Okay, first of all, it is... Again, there is no magic potion. There is no hocus pocus. There is no abracadabra. This is... It takes people a lifetime to achieve this Qalbin Saleem. What we are trying to achieve in this course is that we identify all the problems, because if you don't know that you are suffering from a disease, you will never cure it. So inshallah, the first thing is to identify ki mere andar ye disease hai, mere andar ye problem hai. Once you've identified that, then we can work on the cure. And constantly keep praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah, I want to purify myself, give me tawfiq to actually do this. And aapko main batau, a lot of the cures that we are mentioning, they are overlapping one another. Aap logon ne observe kiya hoga, a lot of the cures, they overlap. A lot of times I say, you know, tazakkur on the Quran, tafakkur bil Quran, tadabbur al Quran, ye cheezein aati hain. For example, fasting comes over and over again. Things like, for example, sitting with the poor, sitting with the oppressed and needy, it will humble you down. So a lot of these things have to do with, there are a lot of things which are similar. So it's not that every cure is different from the other, there are a lot of similarities. So inshallah, if you start following, so if you do one thing, it will have multiple benefits inshallah. For example, fasting will have multiple benefits on your personality. Likewise, reading Quran will have multiple benefits. Pondering over death and its stages will have multiple benefits inshallah. So make that niya, make that sincere intention with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay, I want to do this, and do it slowly, steadily. Inshallah, I can assure you that if your intention is sincere, if you keep at it consistently, inshallah, one day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will slowly start to rid you of all of these things. I hope that helps inshallah. Jazakallah khair.